viewers, welcome to another new session of Dr. Kamini Rao's Masterclass. I open this session with an excellent quote by Sadie Alexander. Don't let anything stop you, but you can't stop. Make yourself the best that you can make out of what you are, the very best. As you're already wondering, what's going on? Well, let me welcome you to all Kamini Rao's Masterclass. I've always been a follower of lighting the candle instead of cursing the darkness. So how could I let this pandemic stop me from reaching you all? Corona can't stop us from providing the interactive episode of this show. Dr. Kamini Rao's Masterclass will always be there for you. Never get so busy making a living that you forget to make a life. And so, who else can explain this better than our special guest this evening? A man whose social media is a mirror of a happy family time and whose Twitter handle is flooded with informative tweets. The man who portrays a perfect work-life balance, he is none other than Mr. Vinesh Bhatia, CEO of ART Fertility Clinics in India. Thank you for being with us, Mr. Vinesh Bhatia.
Thank you, madam, for having me on the show. And I feel honored and privileged to be talking to you because I have grown myself in this industry from last 28 years in IVF. And for us, being in very nascent stage in early 90s, late 90s, we have always been seeing you as an inspiration for us to grow in life, professionally and personally both. So I sincerely thank from my heart for having me on this show.
Well, Vinesh, you are known as the family man. So could you give us a background in the early days as a family man? What is your background and your education, and how did you get into infertility?
So, it's quite a story, and somewhere it resembles to some old Hindi movie. So, me and my wife both are 49 years of old, and we both know each other from 41 years. So, we have been friends to each other even before when we used to actually know the difference between a boy and a girl. She was my neighbor, and we have grown together. And we were too close friends to even think about marrying each other. And I'm talking about very late 80s environment. And I come from a very humble middle class background. My parents, my mom was a homemaker. My dad was an employee in a PSU bank. And same was my wife's father also. And we have grown up, played all the games which we can play as kids, as teenagers together. We used to go to different school. At one point of inclination in life, when I left my city in Ahmedabad and went to Bombay for studying my graduation, when I went away from her, it's both of us realized in first 8 days that we are not meant to live without each other. And though we were very close friends, we never thought of living life and marrying to each other. I think I was 19 years old at that time, and I got a letter from her, written letter, about how she felt of 8 days of being away from me. And I connected immediately. You will not believe it took me 5 minutes to run to train station, catch a train, leave Bombay, go back to Ahmedabad. I reached at 9:30 p.m. I still remember in the night. And she was surprised to see me because I just read a letter and just ran away. And next day morning, I proposed her. Early 19 for me, early 18, late 18 for her. And it took me 3-4 days to convince her that I will be a good husband and a good partner. And finally, we decided that we will spend life together. And because I was studying back, I went back to Bombay to complete that year of education. I was studying in Bhavan's College in Bombay. I used to write one letter every day night before sleeping. And that was our life. I came back to Ahmedabad next year. And for family reason, being in a very orthodox time, my in-laws were not liking we meeting and dating each other. Dating was not a word which was coined at that time. And there were too many not so great pleasant experience happening. So at stroke of 21, legal age of marriage, I took her from home, went to a court without telling anyone, and I married.
That's so, filmy style, isn't it, Vinesh?
Filmy style, I still, when I look back, I really feel that how did I gather that courage at the age of 21 to take her from home and just went to court and did my marriage. I was only accompanied by my elder brother. There was no one with me. And when I came back, there was so much hue and cry in both the family, and they all started fighting. So I did not felt conducive of staying there in Ahmedabad. So I went to a village town for 8 days. This was 8 days before my final exam of BSc, Bachelor of Science. And it was very sensational.
No, was it all in the newspapers?
No, not in newspaper. So after 8 days of being in a village town, I came back, gave my exam, final year exam. And I cleared with, at that time, distinction was a very, very rare thing in college. I stood first in college. And then I thought, I'm done. I am with my childhood friend, the best partner I could have. And I completed my graduation and wanted to do my master's in science and MBA at that time. I was very ambitious to study more. My wife told me one day, we were sitting on a beach, again in a very small remote town in Gujarat, having a coconut water. And she told me that, don't you think you should start earning? I said, why? My dad is doing fairly well and I think I can study. She said, I'm not feeling good of even asking and you asking money from your parents because we wanted to go out for a holiday for a day. It struck me and I went to the town back in the evening, could not find one English newspaper. But I did hard work, went to a railway station because the station master was Hindi speaking. He was not Gujarati. He was reading Times of India. I picked up paper and he lent me a newspaper for half an hour. I copied advertisements, which was there in Times Ascent at that time, applied handwritten application. I appeared for my first interview 1 week later, first application and my first job. So I started my journey very early in life, being a medical representative, because I married very early and because my wife wanted me to earn.
So then what happened was that you got into this, so you didn't continue your higher studies there?
No, ma'am. I could not, and there was no regret in my life. I was very happy what I chose at that time.
So you sat with a bachelor's degree and then you said to yourself, love is more important and therefore I will go ahead and with a bachelor's degree, I will do whatever I want, but I have my lady love next to me and I have actually kept her happy. Oh, what a family man that is, isn't it? Huh? I'm sure all the viewers, the lady viewers that are going to be looking at this are going to really love you. And with the chocolate face that you have, I'm sure this is really going to appeal to them. So, Vinesh, I think this is good what you did. And you know, you really stuck to it. You had that kind of courage right from childhood that I can see. The ability to go out and get a registered marriage in those days, and being from a conservative family itself shows that you had it in your DNA that you wanted to succeed, and whatever you set your eyes on, you actually accomplished it and you didn't actually look back. And perhaps the seeds of that kind of courage were sown very early in your life. How were your siblings?
So, madam, I have elder brother.
And, yes.
We both are very opposite in personality. I am expressive. I am very outspoken, extrovert. He used to be an introvert, a very sincere brother to me, and a very good friend of mine. This also may be surprise you. We have stayed together for long. Even after my marriage, he is an elder brother. He married later than me. Me, my wife, my brother, and his wife, we used to stay together for some years. Me and my brother, I don't remember in 49 years of my life and 51 years of my brother that we have fought ever. Not even once. And so my
not
brother was, sorry?
Not even the wives?
So my brother's wife and my wife had their good days and bad days.
Then what happened to the bad days? The brothers patched up, is it?
Yeah, both the brothers will patch up well with the wife. And my brother left India very early. He was pursuing in computer studies again too early in the early 90s time. And he got a good opportunity and he left India 17 years before now. So he's very well settled as a senior position in IT company in Canada.
That's very good. So from there on, you went across from there to Mumbai, and as a medical representative, you were quite happy, you know, going across everywhere, meeting doctors, etc. How did you find that profession?
Either my story of life is interesting or I always feel it is interesting. I don't know. So when I picked up my bag first, my first day, and I met a gynecologist. I started my career with Serum Institute, which is now known for COVID vaccine. But in my days when I joined there, Serum was very much known for one of the pioneer company to import fertility hormones. And we were responsible to impart a lot of education how to treat infertility. So I'm talking about days which you know better than me, but my heart story was that when I used to go to meet gynecologists, and I remember my first day when I was promoting clomiphene citrate HCG, it was fascinating thing. In Ahmedabad, there were 7 or 8 doctors using HCG at that time out of the whole city. And I realized that it's a very subtle connect for me that being medical representative, we were actually imparting knowledge to a doctor. I'm talking about an environment when doctors and engineers were the highest social strata. And many people used to tell me, the kind of job I used to have, pick up the bag, go and request doctor and go to chemist. I loved from day one. Because I realized on day one that when I'm talking about clomiphene citrate and HCG, the gynecologist was listening to me patiently. Because I then realized that during that time, there was hardly even a chapter of infertility in gynecology studies, even in MS or MD. So I felt that I am doing some good by imparting whatever knowledge my company is giving to me, which was coming through Serono, and it is helping a doctor to treat infertile patient and to achieve the dream of parenthood, at that time more of motherhood. And I still feel very interesting to me that during that time infertility was considered as personal shortcoming. It was never accepted or considered a medical disease. Most people used to feel it's their destiny to be infertile, and they used to only go to astrologers, some babas and some temples, mosque, whatever religion they follow, and not coming to doctor. So I felt very connected very early to this job, that some difference, I being very junior person in the strata of a medical ecosystem, at least I'm making some difference. Another interesting thing, as a medical representative, we always used to have a group of people meeting at a place and have a cup of tea. Most people I found, I don't know whether it is the right word. Most people I found cursing the job. That we have to go and request doctor, we have to go and request chemist, and we have to listen to our managers. I was at that time in minority, which I today feel was probably my personality or my core nature. I used to always say it's a beautiful job because we are imparting knowledge. We are making difference in life of people. And when you go to chemist, and even if a chemist is very busy and will not want you to give any feedback, I never used to feel insulted or bad. I used to come back and ask to the chemist that whenever you have time, let me know, I'll come. I need feedback before meeting the doctor. I mean, it will be surprising to you. Some of my best friends today also are people who were chemists at that time, who have grown in their life. They have become distributors. Some of them have done very well in life. Some of them have migrated to US. So doctors and medical stores became my best friends. I thought that I found a lot of joy out of it. And again, my inner connect was always there that if I am getting 3,000 rupees a month from a job, which is helping me to live peace. We live happily with my wife. And I had my first kid very early. I was myself kid when I had my first kid. I always had this connect in my life that anything which is helping me to live my life happily with my wife, with my children, if I'm being able to feed them from my job, I used to love that job for that reason. And that was enough for me.
That's good. So when you do this, I think you invested in people and relationships, which is very important, because no institution is built by brick and mortar. It's always by people. And people make successful institutions and make, you know, businesses successful, as I always think, because unless you have good teams. So you're also known as we go along that you then graduated from being a farmer person to getting into the IVF. And when did this feeling of getting into the ART clinics and then become a marketing person, purely because of the interest that you had in the ART, you were able to get into the marketing side as well? And what's important, your connect with the doctors in the medical field, because of your job, your previous job, it actually helped you and paved your way to get into the marketing field. So you were able to sort of seamlessly transfer yourself into that kind of this thing. Did you find any challenges in that? Because you very quickly rose high in the clinics, and I think Nova was your first job, and you were able to do that very well. What challenges did you face in that, and how did you overcome that? Or are there any instances where you had failures, and how did you overcome that?
I can take, so the journey of Nova did not started by accident. I can connect how it happened and why probably I was very confident also to take up that challenge. So early in my days, again, maybe in my early days, because of my sincerity or because of my passion for my work, I had grown very well and very fast up in the ladder in my first company also. And then it was late 90s, 1999, when we launched the first recombinant FSH in India. I was part of 20 member team who launched recombinant, and I still remember it was like dream me going to London, being trained under Peter Brinsden about the shift from highly purified FSH to recombinant FSH, and it was very interesting. But the sad part was that we were not successful in India to sell recombinant the way it was expected from us. One incident I can narrate. A very senior person from my parent company, Serono, came for one of the doctor meeting which we used to organize, and it was Professor Bruno Lunenfeld and Mr. Tai. He was Vice President Asia Pacific, very senior person, and I was at quite a middle level management in Serum, and he was asking me that why do you think we are not being able to sell recombinant FSH? And I being always candid, I told that the price difference is too much for the country like India to absorb that, and the difference is from 95% purity to 99% purity, and there is no evidence that urinary impurity has any adverse impact on human body. Why do you think people will shift and pay 100% more? I take this learning as one of the most potential learning I had in my life, which helped me to cross the bridge and go to service side. He said, while promoting a product to doctor, we partner with them in terms of helping a doctor to increase or improve his practice, and then ask for your share. Do not go and sell product, because we will not be able to bring that change in the market if you just go and promote your product. It still resonates in my mind. And then I worked with some of the very senior doctors, very good friend of yours in Ahmedabad, and piloted that. We organized 50 IMA lectures, 25 Gynec Society lectures. I everything spearheaded myself in terms of planning, executing everything. And from 10-15 cycle practice, that doctor's practice went up to 50 cycle per month in 1 year. And I asked my lion's share of recombinant FSH, because that practice was never there. That gave me a platform to know that if you are passionate about something, if you really want to execute something, you can bring that change. It's about thinking out of the box and executing it. I kept on doing that for many doctors and across India, and I kept on growing in pharma field because of this out-of-box understanding. I still feel that the first 100 IUA workshops, which were organized in IVF clinics, so that doctor, gynecologist, does good IUI and sends failure of IUI for IVF, were organized because we started this journey. It will be again sound very amusing to you. While organizing IUI workshop, identifying doctors, inviting them, ensuring they come, I have also sit in a IVF doctor's pantry, made sandwiches for the IUI doctors, the doctors who used to come for workshop, just to help the staff, help the doctor, that you focus on the training, I'll focus on being the host. And I used to make sandwich for doctors, being a senior manager in pharma. The point is that I used to love to bring that change, and when I was very happy what I was doing, I was heading pharma company's IVF division and doing very well for before Nova and Bharat Serum. When I got this call.
Okay, and you got this call, then what did you do?
So I got a call that there is one group of private equity players, and they are in daycare surgery business, but they think that they want to explore into single specialty in IVF, because one of the doctor who was coming for endoscopic surgery in their daycare surgery model suggested that why don't you foray into IVF. They did some homework and they found it's very nascent stage and it can be explored. So Dr. Banker called me that would you mind to come and give a business presentation, because I would be more on clinical side talking to the board of that company. So being good friends, and I had the kind of respect I have for you, I always had for Dr. Praveen Patel and Dr. Bankan. So I went to give a presentation, not wanting to plunge, but just wanting to share knowledge which I had. And I gave a 1 hour presentation. I made that presentation on my way from Bombay to Bangalore in flight. Because for me, it was like just pouring my thoughts out. And post presentation, they asked me to join, and they offered me in that meeting itself. It took me one week to think, because it was like a big shift for me from pharma to healthcare, and many of doctors, so most of the IVF friends were, IVF doctors in India were my friends. I took clue from some of them. Most of them were very unhappy of me thinking this. In fact, a couple of them said that you are burning your bridge, going to another side and being our competitors. In my mind, there was one thing which was very sure, that if the way I believe how this market can be expanded, then instead of burning my bridge, I'll make better friends. And to one doctor, I told this, that you are here in this industry, I'm going to hear, this is where I will spend my life. After 3 years, we will talk again, that whether going that side, if I have expanded the market, made good for me also, but made good for the industry also, or I have taken any share from any existing IVF center. So I was very sure, having this concept in my mind, that this will only help the industry also. Of course, it will help Nova, but it will help me also to grow as a professional.
Yes, I think you did have an idea, but the one thing that I have noticed as far as you've worked your way up, I've always found that you had a burning desire to do more and to learn more, and you've always learned on the job. You've never gone across to a business school to learn how to actually manage business. You know, it's always said that, you know, Gujaratis are very good in handling business, and however small the amount may be, they're able to double it very fast. But that, I think, is in your genes. But apart from that, I feel that you're able to sort of take teams with you. How do you actually go across? Everyone said you need a KOL to start a business, and that IVF cannot be scaled up, and you've always got to have a person who's going to lead that clinic. But you are one person who believed that you could take youngsters, promote them, put them into different centers, And it is always the marketing that brings the patients inside and the clinicians that get the success. And the clinicians and the marketing become very important to get the success of the clinic. So in this venture, I always felt that equal importance was given to marketing and to the doctors. What's your say on this?
Working on ground in pharma and my conditioning helped me to think probably innovative or one step ahead. The reason I am saying that I probably can visibly see the funnel of infertile patient in India very well. And working on both the side and being on ground across India, I know I have worked in you name any state, and I have worked on bike, on scooter, on in public transport in my early days. So when I see the funnel from my angle, there are millions of couples in India who are infertile, subfertile. Not many come to medical treatment, but the first step in India, not right clinically, but in the societal terms, it is considered woman's problem. So the group of patients out of that millions of patients who believe that it's a medical disease and want to take medical help will go to gynecologist. In India, when I stepped into service side of healthcare side of IVF, we had 30,000 plus gynecologists. And we had a handful of IVF clinics, about 500. This was always in my mind that 9 out of 10 people who require IVF will be stuck at gynecologist and will not come to IVF center because they will not. There is no way they will know where they should go. And you will not believe that I did a very in-depth, deep stick study before making the blueprint of Nova's business plan. And it was talking to about more than 500 gynecologists one-on-one, where I said very simple 3 questions. Do you see infertile patients? Many or some of these patients require IVF. If yes, do you refer? If no, why? And my that study, which it was not a published study, it was for our internal reason. 100% of gynecologists said that we have infertility patient. More than 90% gynecologists said that yes, many of the patients require IVF. Ironically, more than 75% gynecologists said that we don't refer to IVF centers. And my only question was why? And you will be again surprised, the very, very common answer. IVF is very costly. IVF is not ethical. Third, most important thing, that they were not sure about what is the result, sub 30%. Why should patients spend so much of money where results are so poor? The most important thing which came out here was that why should I refer my patient when I'm losing my patient? So it's not like path lab or sending for an X-ray or sending for some radiology. I'll not get my patient back. And then this struck me very strong. And I had then very difficult, very long meeting with our medical director to dismantle their obstetric practice before starting clinic in Nova then. So we put together the dots that if we go to this 30,000 gynecologists or 500 gynecologists in every city where we have IVF center, and it's very simple. You have IVF, you have patient who require IVF, you send it to us. It's win-win business model. We are not competing to you. We will make them pregnant and send it back to you. And this worked well in terms of very simple business terms, because 90% of patients were with them. There was no point competing with them. So we became friends, and the journey started well like this. Now, another part of question. I believe that first and foremost, I want to clarify this. I always had kept my eye that if I am promoting healthcare or if I am in business head of a healthcare, the product has to be best. So there was never compromise on lab, technology, equipments, SOP, protocol. The results has to be good. There's no focus left from that. At the same time, I always believe that if you have a good product or a good service, it needs to be marketed well, and it has to be backed by lots of clinical, lots of study or research, whatever you have. So I still believe that if you have right doctor with right mindset and you have right ecosystem to churn the result well, it's not that we need a very senior KOL, but with the right ecosystem of giving the best in class clinical outcome and right marketing format or execution. I had early belief, I don't mind telling this, my company's management never believed this, that it will work. I had many levels of bitter arguments, discussions with my management when I was building my very strong and very senior sales team. And I was being always told that this will not work. And I was always telling, please wait and watch. Give me 6 months, it will work. After 1 year, it was never looking back. And everybody believed that this is the best way to promote.
Yeah, but Vinesh, what I would say is that the last part of my discussion would be like a rapid fire round. I'm going to ask you a question and you're going to give me a one-liner here. Because, you know, what would be the message for a young gynecologist who has done her fellowship in reproductive medicine, who's wanting to start off an IVF center and is now very disillusioned with so many centers mushrooming up? Do you think that she would be successful? Very short answers, Suresh.
100%. I 100% believe that IVF in India is just taking off. It's not even reached to its saturation level. It's 20 years away. You keep believing in this, it will work for sure.
So what are the attributes and qualities that IVF consultant should have to make it successful?
Very focused on skill set of being an IVF specialist and not diversifying on anything, and keep believing that India is best in terms of its macrodynamics of IVF, and focus on patient. Besides being a very good doctor, a very warm person is a fantastic combination.
So, in fact, what about the SOPs and the protocols and all the kind of things where most of them would like to add another extra room and call their nursing homes as an IVF center? What's your take on that?
My belief is that if you want to become a successful IVF consultant, IVF doctor, be purely in IVF.
What is your take on a couple where the gynecologist is the lady and the husband who belongs to a different profession, like for example a surgeon, ENT, a cardiologist, dermatologist, suddenly then buckles up and becomes a embryologist with some 3 or 4 weeks training somewhere, and then starts doing embryology, and then as a couple they start doing an IVF center, and then starts proclaiming that this is how we're going to do, while he still continues to do his other specialty and part-time he does the embryology. Do you think such a center will work?
Absolutely not, madam. My view is that the most important aspect of successful IVF center is the heart of the business, which is IVF lab. Embryologist has to be 100% focused, leave that passion of the lab, SOP, protocol, technology, and the work. Embryology is very, very demanding and focused job to do, to be 100% dedicated to that.
And Vinesh, again, how important are audits and how frequent should audits be done in IVF clinics?
My view is that it is very, very critical part of successful IVF unit and consistent success rate and improving success rate. Very, very critical. It may sound amusing. I don't think it is periodically required. It's required real time, 24/7.
And how important are the counseling visits for patients who had a negative beta HCG? And how often should a senior consultant who's done the case see the patient after the negative beta HCG?
So counseling is one of the important aspect of a successful unit. We discussed about sales, marketing and clinical, and we have missed discussing about it. But most players or most IVF service providers, even in organized chain, have missed giving importance to the third vertical, is the operations clinic staff. and to handle patient emotionally at every step is very important key in successful IVF unit. So having a trained psychologist and having a continuous training program for a psychologist is important in IVF. But for a negative beta HCG, a senior doctor or a treating doctor should always meet after the beta HCG negative and counsel patient and then hand it over to the psychologist.
That was a wonderful exposition of a marketing person telling us how the IVF is going to go forward, and also some insights as to how marketing should be done and how marketing is really an art and not only a science, as we are thinking today that it's not about giving some money and then getting doctors to come and practice in your centers, etc. I think, you know, they go hand in hand. I think there must be growth for the referring doctors, there must be growth for the marketing person, and there must be growth for the doctors that are working in the center. So even in corporate hospitals, I think they all must work in unison. It's only then that the IVF centers can scale up. And with these few words, I must thank you, Vinesh Padia. It has been a pleasure talking to you today. And I do hope that we will be able to meet sometime. Thank you, viewers, for having had this interactive session today. Dr. Kamini Rao's Masterclass. See you soon.